Hershey and Chase's Warring Blender experiment. This is an experiment that is very significant in molecular biology, and interestingly, it is also a very simple experiment. So the outcomes of this video would be that we would all come to know the experimental design and why the name Warring Blender experiment. We all can appreciate why it is one of the most remarkable experiments in molecular biology. And also the fact that this was the experiment through which Hershey and Chase proved that genetic material is DNA and not protein. And of course, like Roger Herriot, even Hershey and Chase used radioisotopes and bacteriophages to prove that DNA is the genetic material. So Hershey and Chase, in the 1950s, they were working with viruses, especially bacteriophages. And in fact, it was during the same time that Roger Herriot also carried out his experiments. And there are a lot of things about bacteriophages that actually Hershey and Chase were responsible for finding in terms of the life cycle, etc. So they carried out a series of experiments to take forward the work of Avery McLeod and McCarty. They were really intrigued with the results and the experiments of Avery McLeod and McCarty, and they wanted to basically also look at, therefore, whether and confirm whether DNA is the genetic material. Because post Avery McLeod McCarty's studies, although they definitely tried to say that DNA is the genetic material, there was a school of thought that believed that proteins are the genetic material, and there were beyond that on and off a lot of debate on whether actually DNA is the genetic material. Those that believed that protein is the genetic material actually doubted Avery McLeod McCarty's claim and said that it may be so that in the purified DNA sample there were proteins present, and it's not the protein, it's not the DNA, but it's the proteins that could have been responsible for the transformation. So therefore that continued, and Hershey and Chase actually took up that contention of whether DNA is a genetic material or protein is the genetic material. So their first experiment was that of actually looking at viral proteins and nucleic acids functioning separately in maintaining the life cycle of the phages. They used the technique of radioisotope labeling to distinguish between DNA and proteins. The same, basically it is the same concept that Roger Herriot also took up. So almost all the labs during those days were working with DNA, were working with proteins, and were working with bacteriophages. And also the fact that because radioisotopes were available to study biology, to study these biomolecules, they were taken up. And even Hershey and Chase did the same. And with a very important strategy, because they were able to kind of look at the fact that DNA can be labeled with P32, while protein can be labeled with S35. And therefore, the radioactivity that could be observed due to P32 would be different from that would be observed for S35. And therefore, the distinction between DNA and protein can be done. Now, let's look at how the bacteriophages were labeled. This we had also seen when we had looked at Roger Herriot's experiment. So what is done is that E. coli is grown in a media containing S35, which means that when E. coli grows, the S35 is incorporated into the amino acids like cysteine, and these cysteine in turn form proteins which are present inside the E. coli. So therefore, the E. coli itself will contain proteins that are S35. Now, if you that contain S35. Now, if you allow a bacteriophage to infect these E. coli, And when these bacteriophages start multiplying within the E. coli, these bacteriophages will also incorporate S35 in their protein coat. And hence, you will have the bacteriophages coated with S35 label. Similarly, the bacteriophages were labeled for P32. So as one can observe, in a media containing P32, when the phages were grown, the phages basically took up, when they multiplied, their DNA that was synthesized inside the host E. coli incorporated P32 within their own genome. So therefore, this bacteriophage will become labeled with P32. So just when you look at it a little, if you basically go in for a higher resolution, what you observe is that bacteriophage infects the bacteria, and that bacteria has already taken up radioisotopes. So therefore, when this bacteriophage multiplies inside the host bacteria, all the phages that will be formed will be labeled phages. So this is how the phages were labeled. Thus, S35 labeled and P32 labeled T-type bacteriophages were obtained for the experiment. Let me again remind you, P32 is for DNA and S35 is for protein. Hence, those bacteriophages which showed radioactivity for S35 had their protein coats labeled, and those bacteriophages that showed radioactivity for P32 had their DNA labeled. Now let us actually come to the experiment. So he carried out two sets, or they carried out two sets of experiment. In one set of experiment, they allowed the phage to grow in a media containing the S35, and another phage or a set of phages was grown in a media containing P32. So to differentiate between the two, they are basically coloring the radioactive protein as yellow and the radioactive DNA as green. So therefore, these phages were labeled for P32 and these phages were labeled for S35. So if you're going to study in this set, you're going to basically look at the proteins. And in this set, what you're going to look out for is the DNA. So you can already see that here you are going to check what is happening to the protein, and here you are going to check what is happening to the DNA of the bacteriophage. Now this is important because the T2 phage as a particle is containing DNA and proteins. So therefore, what or where is the protein and what or where is the DNA decides which one is the genetic material. So like I mentioned, they allowed the phage to infect the E. coli these phages were allowed to multiply within the E. coli. Now, however, what was done is that they allowed the DNA of the virus to multiply only for one generation. Why is that so? Is because the phages that are there are attached to the bacteria. This is what was already understood when they had studied the life cycle of bacteriophages. That is, the bacteriophage attaches to the bacteria, injects the DNA inside the bacteria, and the host phage, or rather the protein coat, remains out on the surface attached to the cell wall. Now, if you were to basically look at which is the genetic material, then if you consider this E. coli as a whole with the bacteriophage attached to it, you will not be able to say whether it is the protein or the DNA, because you will have both the protein and the DNA attached to E. coli. What was Hershey and Chase trying to basically look at? Whether it is DNA that remains inside the bacteria and therefore is responsible for further multiplication of bacteriophages, or is it protein that is responsible for multiplication of the bacteriophages? So their simple idea was that if they took the E. coli that was attached to by the bacteriophages and put them in a Waring blender. So that is why the name of the experiment was Waring blender. Then just running this mixy, they could detach the empty protein shells or the ghost bacteriophages from the E. coli. So now what therefore is happening? The ghost bacteriophages are on their own and the E. coli containing the DNA will be on their own. These were then centrifuged. On centrifugation, the E. coli being larger particles or heavier than the ghost bacteriophages, it is inevitable that the bacteria will pellet out. So it'll be present in the pellet after centrifugation, while the ghost bacteriophages will remain in the supernatant. So having got the centrifugation done, now what Hershey and Chase had to do is look for where is the radioactivity present, whether it is in the pellet or whether it is in the supernatant. The same is in this case. It is exactly the same steps, but here they were going to look for S35 radioactivity and here they were going to look for P32 radioactivity, because these were bacteriophages that were labeled with P32 and these were bacteriophages that were labeled with S35. So when this centrifuge tube was checked for radioactivity, it was found that 99% of radioactivity of S35 was observed in the supernatant and only about 1% was found in the pellet. So this was observation number one. In this case, after the Waring blender and the centrifugation step, what was observed is that in the supernatant there was no or just about 1% P32 radioactivity, while in the pellet there was 99% radioactivity of P32. So what was the conclusion? The conclusion was that the protein ghost does not enter the E. coli. And in this case, it is very clear that the DNA enters the E. coli, because DNA was found to be, the viral DNA was found to be along with the pellet, which means that it is present within the E. coli. In this case, S35 was found to be in the supernatant and the pellet hardly had any S35, which indicates that the protein does not enter the bacteria. So after injecting the DNA within it, the bacteriophage host does not enter the E. coli at all. Now, fine. The question was, what happens next? So when these were continued to be growing, these were taken and grown in another fresh media, virus particles were formed and they were released in the culture. The same was observed in this. The virus particles were formed and they were seen in culture, which means that it is the DNA which is the genetic material, because we understand that if there is multiplication, then the multiplication is because of the information stored in the genetic material. And therefore, with this experiment, they were very clearly stating that you can clearly differentiate between the protein coat and the DNA. And so it is DNA which takes forward the multiplication of the viral particle rather than the ghost, because the ghost was detached from the E. coli and the E. coli still had the viral particles being formed within it. Therefore, it was DNA that is the genetic material. Therefore, let me make the conclusions again. With nearly all the labeled phosphorus being found in the pellet containing the bacteria, it was clear that the nucleic acid component of the T2 phage was released into the bacteria, while the ghost bacteriophage remained outside the bacteria. Therefore, in the debate between proteins or nucleic acids being the genetic material, DNA won the battle as established by Hershey and Chase in this experiment. The simple thought that using a warring blender would just detach the fudge from the host enabled a clear distinction in where the proteins would be moments after infection released and where would the DNA be. Therefore, Hershey and Chase's experiments was the experiment after S.F. Griffith's and Avery McLeod-McCarthy's experiment that put a final seal on the fact that DNA is the genetic material. Therefore, one can only conclude that a simple thought like making use of a warring blender was responsible for detaching the proteins from the DNA, and that detachment was clearly showing which is the genetic material. Simple yet remarkable. And Hershey and Chase, this experiment was the experiment that initiated, in actuality, the study of DNA and molecular biology took off from this point on. Thank you.